As the blue Rolls number OA1217 came to rest with a sickening thud against the back of the big barn outside Easterton Village, Tarnith was half stunned by the blow on her head and painfully winded by the wheel which caught her in the stomach. She realized that she had escaped serious injury and that the police would be on her at any moment. She threw open the door of the Rolls and staggered out onto the grass. She lurched at an unsteady run across the coarse tussocks, and as the torches of the police appeared over the hillock, she took a chance and ran for it, trusting in the darkness of the night. After she'd covered a mile, she flopped exhausted to the ground, drawing short gulping breaths into her straining lungs, her heart thudding like a hammer. From what she remembered of the map, the house at Chilbury, where the Satanists were gathering preparatory to holding the Great Sabbat, was a dozen miles away. It would be impossible for her to cover that distance on foot, and the fact that she was wanted by the police debarred her from trying to seek a lift in a passing car if she were able to find the main road again. In spite of her desperate attempt to reach the rendezvous in the stolen Rolls and the frantic excitement of her escape from the police, she found to her surprise that a sudden reaction had set in and she no longer felt that terrible driving urge to be present at the Sabbat. Her anger against Rex had subsided. She began to wonder seriously for the first time if he was not right, and that during these last months, which she had spent with Madame Durfay, her brain had become clouded almost to the point of mania by this obsession to the exclusion of all natural and reasonable thoughts. She recalled those queer companions who were travelling upon the same path as herself, most of them far further advanced upon it, of whom she had seen so much in recent times. The man with the hare lip, the one-armed Eurasian, the albino and the barbu. They were not normal, any one of them, and while living outwardly the ordinary life of moneyed people, dwelt secretly in a strange, sinister world of their own, flattering themselves and each other upon their superiority to normal men and women, on account of the strange powers that they possessed, yet egotistical and hard-hearted to the last degree. Feeling that now Rex had succeeded in preventing her reaching the meeting place, he would be certain to call off the police, she set out at a brisk pace away from Easterton, towards where she believed the main Salisbury Devizes road to lie, hoping to find a temporary shelter for the night and then make her way back to London in the morning. Before she had gone 200 yards, a dark, hunched figure seemed to form out of the shadows beside her. She started, but recovered herself at once on realizing that it was only a bent old woman.
"You've lost your way, dearie."
"Yes," Tarnith admitted. "Can you show me how I get onto the Devizes Road?"
"I am going that way myself,"
said the old woman in a husky voice which seemed to Tarnith in some strange way vaguely familiar.
"Give me your hand, dearie. The way is rough for my old feet."
And Tarnith willingly offered her arm. Then, as the old woman rested a claw upon it, a sudden memory of long ago flooded her mind. It was of the days when, as a little girl living in the foothills of the Carpathians, she had made a friend of an old gypsy woman who used to come to the village for the fair and local saints' days. It was from her that Tarnith had first learned her strange powers of clairvoyance and second sight. Many a time she had scrambled down from the rocky mount upon which her home was set to the gypsy encampment outside the village to gaze with marvelling eyes at old Miska, who knew so many wonderful things and could tell of the past and of the future by gazing into a glass of water or consulting her grimy pack of tarot cards. Old Miska had been a willing teacher, and Tarnith, long before her time, had learned all the secrets of life from the old gypsy. "Miska," Tarnith whispered, "it is you, isn't it?"
"Yes, dearie, yes, old Miska has come a long way tonight to set her pretty one upon the roads."
"But how did you ever come to England?
No matter, dearie. Don't trouble your golden head about that. Old Miska started you upon the road, and she has been sent to guide your feet tonight.
But I don't want to go. Not today.
What foolishness is this? It is the road that you have taken all your life, ever since Miska told you of it as a little girl. Tonight is the night that old Miska has seen for so many years in her dreams, the night when you shall know all things and be granted powers which come to few. How fortunate you are to have this opportunity when you are yet so young.
At the woman's silken words, a new feeling crept into Tanith's heart. Now she was drawn back into another world, the one of which she had thought so long, in which a very few chosen people could perform the seemingly impossible, bend others to their will, cause them to fall or rise, place unaccountable obstacles in their path at every turn, or smooth their way to a glorious success. That was more than riches, more than fame, the supreme pinnacle to which any man or woman could rise, and all her longing to reach those heights before she died came back to her.
It is not far, dearie, not so far as you have thought. The great festival does not take place in the house at Chilbury. That was only a meeting place, and the Sabbath is to be held up on these downs only a few miles from here. Come with me.
A curtain of forgetfulness seemed to be falling over Tarnit's mind. A feeling of intoxication, mental and physical, flooded through her. She felt her eyes closing, as she muttered, "Yes, knowledge and power. Hurry, Miska, hurry, or we shall be too late." Miska, walking at Tanith's left, suddenly pulled up, clutching at her arm.
"Shut your eyes, dearie! Shut your eyes! There is something here that is not good for you to see. I will guide you."
Tanith did as she was bid mechanically. She had a feeling that she was no longer alone with the old woman, but that a third person was now walking with them. Then a low voice, bell-like and clear, sounded in her ears. "Tanith, my darling, look at me, I implore you." At the shock of hearing that well-loved voice, Tanith opened her eyes again. She saw the figure of her mother, dressed in white as she had last seen her before she had set out to some great party where she had died of a sudden heart attack. Round her neck hung a rope of pearls, and her head was adorned with a half hoop of diamond stars. The figure shone by some strange, unnatural light in the surrounding darkness, seeming as pure and translucent as carved crystal. "My dear one," the voice went on, "my folly of encouraging your gift of second sight has led you into terrible peril. I beg you by all that is good and holy to draw back while there is yet time. I am only allowed to appear to you because of your great danger and for the briefest space. I am called back already, but I beg you in the name of the love that we had for each other not to go. There is a better influence in your life. Trust in it while there is still time. Otherwise you will be dragged down into the pit and we shall never meet again." Suddenly the voice changed, becoming cold and commanding.
"Back, Miska! Back whence you came! I order you by the names of Isis, mother of Horus, Kuan Yin, mother of Hoki, and Mary, mother of our Lord."
Tanith dashed forward, but where the apparition of her mother had been a second before, only a little breeze ruffled the long grasses. A feeling of immense fatigue bowed her shoulders as she turned towards old Miska, but she too had vanished. Almost unconsciously she rose to her feet and found herself standing upon a hilltop, gazing down into a shallow valley. A new and terrible fear gripped at her heart, for she saw below her, by the strange, unearthly light of a ring of blue candles, the Satanists gathering for their unholy ceremony, and knew that evil powers had led her feet by devious paths to the place of the great Sabbat, that she might participate after all. Time ceased to exist for Tanith then. At the sight of Dirishlo's breakdown, Rex almost gave in too. The collapse of that indomitable leader to whom he had looked so often and with such certain faith in the worst emergencies brought him a new feeling of responsibility. His generous nature was great enough to realize that the Duke's courage had only proved less than his own on this occasion because of his greater understanding of the peril they were called upon to face. "We can't let this thing be," he said with sudden firmness. "You stay here. I'm going down to face the music."
"No, no, Rex!" The Duke grabbed at his coat. "They'll murder you without a second thought."
"Will they? We'll see." Rex gave a grating laugh. "Well, if they do, you'll have something you can fix on them that the police will understand. It'll be some consolation to think you'll see to it that these devils swing for my murder if they do me in."
"Wait!"
"I won't let you go alone." The Duke stumbled to his feet. "Don't you realize that death is the least thing I fear? One look from the eyes of the goat could send you mad. Then where is the case to put before the police? Half the people in our asylums may be suffering from a physical lesion of the brain, but the others are unaccountably insane. The real reason is demoniac possession, brought about by looking upon terrible things that they were never meant to see." He held up the crucifix. "This is going to protect me because I've got faith."
"All right, then, but even madness isn't the worst that can happen to us. This life is nothing. I'm thinking of the next. Oh, God, if only dawn would come, or we had some form of light that we could bring to bear on these worshippers of darkness."
"Wait!" the Duke exclaimed with sudden excitement. "I've got it! This way, quick!"
He turned and set off up the hill. Rex followed.
"What's the idea?"
"The car! The car!" Dirishlo panted.
Rex reached it first and flung open the door. The Duke tumbled in and got the engine going. They bumped forward in the darkness to the brow of the hill.
"Out on the running board, Rex!"
snapped Dirishlo as he thrust out the clutch. He seemed in those few moments to have recovered all his old steel-like indomitable purpose.
"It's a madman's chance, because it's 10 to 1. We'll get stuck going up the hill on the other side, but we must risk that. When I use the engine again, snap on the lights. As we go past, throw your crucifix straight at the thing on the throne, then try and grab Simon by the neck."
Rex laughed, all his tension gone now that he was at last going into action.
"Go to it!"
The car slid forward, silently gathering momentum as it rushed down the steep slope. Next second, they were almost upon the nearest of the Satanists. The Duke let in the clutch, and Rex switched on the powerful headlights of the Hispano. With the suddenness of a thunderclap, a shattering roar burst upon the silence of the valley, as though some monster plane was diving full upon that loathsome company from the cloudy sky. At the same instant, the whole scene was lit in all its ghastliness by a blinding glare which swept towards them at terrifying speed. The great car bounded forward. The dazzling beams threw into sharp relief the naked forms gathered in the hollow. Dirishlo jammed his foot down on the accelerator and, calling with all his will upon the higher powers for their protection, charged straight for the goat of Mendes upon his satanic throne. At the first flash of those blinding lights which struck full upon them, the Satanists rushed screaming for cover. The effect was as that of a fire hose suddenly turned upon an angry, threatening mob. Their maniacal exultation died away. They woke as from an intoxicated nightmare to the realization of their nakedness and helplessness. As the grotesque nude figures scattered with shrieks of terror, the car bounded from ridge to ridge, heading straight for the monstrous goat. When the lights fell upon it, Rex feared for an instant that the malefic rays which streamed from its baleful eyes would overcome the headlights of the car. The lamps flickered and dimmed, but as the Duke clung to the wheel, he was concentrating with all the power of his mind upon visualizing the horseshoe surmounted by a cross in silver light just above the center of his forehead, setting the symbol in his aura and at the same time repeating the lines of the 91st Psalm, which is immensely powerful against all evil manifestations. Whoso dwelleth under the defence of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say unto the Lord, Thou art my hope and my stronghold, my God, in him will I trust, for he shall deliver thee from the snare of the hunter and from the noisome pestilence. From the time Rex switched on the headlights, it was only a matter of seconds before the big car hurtled forward like a living thing right onto the ground where the Sabbath was being held. Rex, clinging to the coachwork and also visualizing that symbol which de Richelieu had impressed so strongly upon him, leaned from the step of the car and with all his force threw the ivory crucifix straight in the terrible face of the monstrous beast. The Duke swerved the car to avoid the throne, and Simon, who alone of all the Satanists remained standing but apparently utterly unconscious of what was happening. The blue flames of the black candles set upon the hellish altar went out as though quenched by some invisible hand. The lights of the car regained their full brilliance, and once again they heard the terrible screaming as the crucifix passed through the face of the goat. A horrible stench of burning flesh mingled with the choking odor from the sulphur candles filled the air like some poisonous gas. The brute upon the rocks disappeared. At the same instant, Rex grabbed Simon by the neck and hauled him bodily onto the step of the car as it charged the farther slope of the hollow. Jolting and bouncing, it breasted the rise. The Duke threw the gear lever into low, and they lurched forward again onto level ground. Rex had flung open the door, dragged Simon inside, where he collapsed on the floor in a senseless heap. De Richelieu did not dare to use the full power of his engine for fear that they should strike a sudden dip or turn over in some hidden gully. For a mile they raced northeastward while the Duke muttered to himself those protective lines. He shall defend thee under his wings, and thou shalt be safe under his feathers. His faithfulness and truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for any terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the sickness that destroyeth in the noonday. They flashed through Earlstoke, Market, Lavington, and then Easterton, where, unseen by them, the blue rolls lay just off the road in a ditch. Then Bushall, up Avon, and so to Andover, having practically completed a circuit of the plain. Here, at last, the Duke brought the car to a halt and turned in his seat to look at Rex. "How is he?" he asked. "Well, he's alive, thank God," murmured Rex. "While you've been driving like a maniac, I've been scared that we have lost poor Simon for good and all. But now we'd best get him back to London, or to the nearest doctor, just as soon as we can." "I daren't." De Richelieu's eyes were full of anxiety. "That devilish mob will have recovered themselves, and are probably back at the house near Chilbury by now. They will be plotting something against us, you may be certain."
"You mean that as Mokara knows you're flat, he will concentrate on it to get Simon back, just as he did before?"
"Worse.
I doubt if they'd ever let us reach it."
Rex frowned impatiently.
"How are they going to stop us?"
"They can control all the meaner things. Bats, snakes, rats, foxes, owls, as well as cats and certain breeds of dogs like the wolfhound and the Alsatian. If one of those dashed beneath the wheels of the car when we were going at any speed, it might turn over. Besides, within certain limits they can control the elements, so they could ensure a dense local fog surrounding us the whole way. If they combine the whole of their strength for ill, it's a certainty they'll be able to bring about some terrible accident before we can cover the 70 miles to London. Remember, too, this is still Walpurgis Nacht, and every force of evil that is abroad will be leagued against us. For every moment until dawn, we three remain in the direst peril."
"Well, we can't stay here," Rex protested.
"I know,
and we've got to find some sanctuary where we can keep Simon safe until morning.
How about a church?
I've got it. We'll take him to the oldest cathedral in Britain, and one that is open to the skies. With a chuckle of relief, de Richelieu set the car in motion again and began to reverse it.
"Surely you're not going back?" Rex asked.
"Only 3 miles to the fork roads at Weyhill, then down to Amesbury. I mean to take him to Stonehenge." A mile outside the town, they ran up the slope to the wire fence which rings in the Neolithic monument, Stonehenge. The Duke drove the car into the deserted car park beside the road, and there they left it. Rex carried Simon, while the Duke followed him through the wire with the suitcase containing his protective impedimenta. They passed the outer circle of great stone uprights, upon some of which the lintels forming them into a ring of arches still remain. Then de Richelieu led the way between the mighty chunks of fallen masonry to where, beside the two great trilithons, the sandstone altar slab lies, half buried beneath the remnants of the central arch. Rex laid Simon, still unconscious, upon it.
"I suppose you know what you're doing, but I've always heard that the Druids who built this place were a pretty grim lot. Didn't they sacrifice virgins on this stone and practice all sorts of pagan rites? I should have thought this place would be more sacred to the power of evil than the power of good."
"Don't worry, Rex," de Richelieu smiled. "It is true that the Druids performed sacrifices, but they were sun worshippers. At the summer solstice, the sun rises over the hilltop there, shedding its first beam of light directly through the arch onto this altar stone. This place is one of the most hallowed spots in all Europe, because countless thousands of long-dead men and women have worshipped here, calling upon the power of light to protect them from the evil things that go in darkness. And the vibrations of their souls are about us now, making a sure buttress and protection until the coming of the dawn." They set about a more careful examination of Simon. They found that, except for where Rex had clawed at his neck, he had suffered no physical injury.
"What do you figure to do now?"
"Exorcise him in due form, in order to try and drive out any evil spirit by which he may be possessed, like the Roman Catholic priests used to do in the Middle Ages, as they still do. Look at that Bavarian family of 11 people, all of whom went out of their minds after a spiritualistic seance in 1921. The case was fully reported by the press at the time, and I could give you a dozen similar examples, all attributable to diabolic possession. In fact, according to the Roman Church, there is no phenomenon of modern spiritism which cannot be paralleled in the records of old witchcraft."
"According to them, maybe, but Simon's not a Catholic."
"No matter. There is nothing to prevent a member of the Roman Church asking divine aid for any man, whatever his race or creed.
Fortunately, I was baptized a Catholic, and although I may not be a good one, I believe that with the grace of God, power will be granted to me this night to help our poor friend.
Kneel down now and pray silently, for all prayers are good if the heart is earnest. But be ready to hold him if he leaps up, for if he is possessed, the demon within him will fight like a maniac." De Richelieu took up the holy water and sprinkled a few drops on Simon's forehead. He remained corpse-like and still. "May the Lord be praised," murmured the Duke. "He is not actually possessed. If he were, the holy water would have scalded him like boiling oil, and at its touch the demon would have screamed like a hellcat. What now, then? He still reeks of evil. So I must employ the banishing ritual to purge the atmosphere about him and do all things possible to protect him from Mokata's influence." Simon was anointed with holy water and with holy oil. The gesture of Horus was made to the north, to the south, to the east, and to the west. The palms of his hands were sprinkled and the soles of his feet. Asafoetida grass was tied around his wrists and his ankles. An orb with the cross upon it was placed in his right hand and a phial of quicksilver between his lips.
A chain of garlic flowers was hung about his neck, and the sacred oil placed in a cross upon his forehead. Each action upon him was preceded by prayer, concentration of thought, and invocation to the archangels, the high beings of light, and to his own higher consciousness. After an hour, all had been accomplished in accordance with the ancient law, and de Richelieu examined Simon again. "I think that with God's help we have saved him," declared the Duke. For a little while the two friends sat silent, the points of their cigars glowing faintly in the darkness, until a pale greyness in the eastern sky made clearer the ghostly outlines of the great oblong stones towering at varying angles to 20 feet above their head. "What a strange place this is," Rex murmured. "How old do you suppose it to be?" "About 4,000 years. Simon stirred beside them, and they both stood up. He slowly turned over and looked about him with dull eyes until he recognized his friends and asked in a stifled voice where he was. De Richelieu drew him down between Rex and himself, on to his knees. "Repeat after me the words of the 51st Psalm. Have mercy upon me, O God, after thy great goodness. According to the multitude of thy mercies, do away mine offences. Wash me thoroughly from my wickedness, and cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my faults, and my sin is ever before me." To the end of the beautiful penitent appeal, the Duke read in a solemn voice from the prayer book by the aid of a little torch, while the others repeated verse by verse after him. Then all three stood up and began at last to talk in their normal voices. De Richelieu explained what had taken place, and Simon sat upon the altar stone, weeping like a child, as now, with a clear brain, he began at last to understand the terrible peril from which his friends had rescued him. Dawn was now breaking in the eastern sky as de Richelieu placed his arm affectionately round Simon's shoulders. "Don't take it to heart so, my friend," he said kindly. "For the moment, at least, you have been spared, and praise be to God, you are still sane, which is more than I dared to hope for when we got you here." Simon nodded. "I know I've been lucky," he said soberly, "but am I really free? For good? I'm afraid MacArthur will try and get me back somehow."
"Now we're together again, you needn't worry," Rex grinned. "If the three of us can't fight his horror and win out, we're not the men I always thought we were."
"Yes," Simon agreed. "But the trouble is that I was born at a time when certain stars were in conjunction, so in a way I'm the key to a ritual which MacArthur set his heart on performing."
"The invocation to Saturn, coupled with Mars," the Duke put in.
"I'm scared he'll exercise every incantation in the book to drag me back to him, despite myself."
"Isn't that danger over?"
"No. The ritual can be performed with a reasonable prospect of success any night while the two planets remain in the same house of the Zodiac."
"Then the longer we can keep you out of MacArthur's clutches, the less chance he has of pulling it off as the two planets get further apart," Rex commented. De Richelieu sighed. "In that case," he said, "MacArthur will exert his whole strength when twilight comes again, and we shall have to fight with our backs to the wall throughout this coming night." Now that the sun was up, Rex's resilient spirit reasserted itself. "What we need most just now is a good hot breakfast." The Duke smiled. "I thoroughly agree. You take the car, Rex, and drive into Amesbury. Find the first clothes dealer you can, and buy Simon an outfit." As Rex strode away across the grass, he turned to Simon. "Tell me," he said, "how did you ever get drawn into this terrible business?" Simon smiled.
"Well," he said, "it may seem a queer thing to say, but you are partly responsible yourself."
"I?" exclaimed the Duke. "What the deuce do you mean?"
"Oh, I'm not blaming you, of course. It started by your telling us about the old alchemists and how they used to make gold out of base metals." Do you mean to tell me that you have been experimenting yourself? And where does Makata come into all this? Simon shuddered at the name. I met him in Paris, he said, at the house of a French banker with whom I've sometimes done business. Castelnau, exclaimed the Duke, the man with the ragged ear. I knew last night that I'd seen that ear somewhere before. Simon nodded. Well, I met Makata at his place. The conversation drifted round to the Kabbalah, and as I had been soaking myself in it at the time, I was naturally interested. He said he had a lot of books upon it and suggested that I might like to visit the house where he was staying and have a look through them. Of course I did. Then he told me that he was conducting an experiment in magic the following night and asked if I would care to be present. I see. That is how the trouble started. Yes? The experiment was quite a harmless affair. He made certain ritual conjurations with the four elements, fire, air, water, and earth, then told me to look into a mirror with him. It was an old Venetian piece, a bit spotted at the back, but otherwise quite ordinary, you know. As I watched, it clouded over with a sort of mist, and when it cleared again, I could no longer see my reflection in it, but a sheet of newspaper instead. It was the financial page of Le Temps, giving all the quotations of the Paris Bourse, which sounds pretty prosaic, I suppose, but the queer part is that this issue was dated 3 days ahead. What happened then? Makata offered to instruct me as the first step on the road to obtaining similar powers myself. My poor Simon, you are not the first to be trapped by a brother of the left-hand path who is recruiting for the devil by such a promise. I had to go back to London a few days later, and I was so impressed by that time that I asked Makata to let me know directly he arrived, because he spoke of coming over. He turned up a fortnight later and rang me up at once to urge me to unload a lot of stock that he knew I was carrying. I had faith in it myself, but in view of what I'd seen in his mirror, I took his tip and saved myself quite a packet, because the market broke almost immediately after. Was that when you asked him to go and live with you? Yes. I suggested that he should stay with me while he was in London because he had no suitable place in which to practice his evocations at his hotel. He moved over to St. John's Wood then, and after that we used to sit up together in the observatory pretty well every night. That's why I saw so little of you during that time. But the results were extraordinary, utterly amazing. He gave you more information which governed your financial transactions, I suppose. Yes, but more than that. He foretold the whole of the Stravinsky scandal. I'm not a poor man, as you know, but if I hadn't been forewarned about that, it would have damn near broken me. As it was, I cleared every single share in the dud companies before the storm broke and got out with an immense profit. Tell me about this man, the Duke said. I mean, his personality, not his appearance. Well, he possesses extraordinary force of character, and he can be the most charming person when he likes. He's clever, amazingly so, and seems to have read pretty well every book that one can think of. It's extraordinary, too, what a fascination he can exercise over women. I know half a dozen who are simply bats about him. What can you tell me of his history? Not much, I'm afraid. His Christian name is Damien, and he's a Frenchman by nationality, but his mother was Irish. He was educated for the church. In fact, he actually took orders. But finding the life of a priest did not suit him, he chucked it up. De Richelieu nodded. I thought as much. Only an ordained priest can practice the Black Mass, and since he is so powerful an adept of the left-hand path, it was pretty certain that he was a renegade priest of the Roman Church. Simon shifted his position. He does the most lovely needlework, petit point, that sort of thing, and he's terribly fastidious about his plump little hands being scrupulously clean. As a companion, he's delightful to be with, except that he will smother himself in expensive perfumes and is as greedy as a schoolboy about sweets. Ordinarily, he was perfectly normal and his manners were charming, but now and again, he used to clear out for a couple of days and nights. I don't know where he used to go, but I ran into him one morning early when he'd just returned, and he was in a shocking state. Filthy dirty, a 2 days' growth of beard on his chin, his clothes all torn and absolutely stinking of drink. It looked to me as if he hadn't been to bed at all the whole time, but had been wallowing in every sort of debauchery down in the slums of the East End. He's quite an exceptional hypnotist, of course, and keeps himself in touch with what is going on in Paris, Berlin, New York, and dozens of other places by throwing various women who used to come and visit him regularly into a trance. One of them was a girl called Tarnith. He says she is by far the best medium he's ever had. He can use her almost like a telephone and plug in right away to whatever he wants to know about. Whereas with the others, there are very often hitches and delays.
You let him hypnotize you, too, of course.
Yes, in order to get those financial results.
I thought as much. And after you'd allowed him to do it willingly for some little time, he was able to block out your own mentality entirely and govern your every thought. That's why you failed to realize what's been going on. Rex appeared and displayed his purchases for their inspection. Simon fingered the garments doubtfully.
I can't return to London in this get-up.
We're not going to London, the Duke announced, but to Cardinal's Folly. What? To Marie Lou's? Rex looked at him sharply.
Simon shook his head. I don't like it. I'd never forgive myself if I brought danger into their home.
You will do as you're told, my friend. De Richelieu's voice brooked no further argument. Richard and Marie Lou are the most mentally healthy couple that I know. The atmosphere of their sane and happy household will be the very best protection we could find for you, and all of us are certain of a warm welcome.
With a shrug of his shoulders, Simon disappeared behind the stones, while Rex added,
I ordered ham and eggs to be got ready at the local inn.
Eggs and fruit, cut in the Duke, but no ham for any of us. It is essential that we should avoid meat for the moment. If we are to retain our astral strength, our physical bodies must undergo a semi-fast at least.
De Richelieu threw a look over his shoulder in Simon's direction.
What is this talisman?
Rex mentioned it last night.
It's the reason why Makata is certain to make every effort to get possession of me again. Simon's voice came back. It's buried somewhere, and adepts of the left-hand path have been seeking it for centuries. It conveys almost limitless powers upon its possessor, and Makata has discovered that its whereabouts will be revealed if he can practice the ritual to Saturn in conjunction with Mars with someone who was born in a certain year at the hour of the conjunction. There can't be many such, but for my sins, I happen to be one.
Yes, I realize that, but what is the talisman?
I don't really know, but it's called the Talisman of Set.
What?
The Talisman of Set?
Yes, it has something to do with four horsemen, I think.
What on earth's the matter?
It has indeed. The four horsemen of the apocalypse. War, plague, famine, and death. We all know what happened the last time those four terrible entities were unleashed to cloud the brains of statesmen and rulers.
You're referring to the Great War, I take it, Rex said.
Of course. And every adept knows that it started because one of the most terrible Satanists who ever lived found one of the secret gateways through which to release the four horsemen.
Well, I thought the Germans got a bit above themselves, Rex hazarded. Although it seems that lots of other folks were pretty well as much to blame.
You fool! De Richelieu suddenly swung upon him. Germany did not make the war. It came out of Russia. It was Russia who instigated the murder at Sarajevo. Russia who backed Serbia to resist Austria's demands. Russia who mobilized first and Russia who invaded Germany. The monk Rasputin was the evil genius behind it all. He was the greatest black magician that the world has known for centuries. It was he who found one of the gateways through which to let forth the four horsemen that they might wallow in blood and destruction. And I know the Talisman of Set to be another. Europe is ripe now for any trouble, and if they are loosened again, it will be final Armageddon.
This is no longer a personal matter of protecting Simon. We've got to kill Mokata before he can secure the talisman and prevent his plunging the world into another war.
Richard Eaton read the telegram a second time. Eat no lunch. This vitally important. Simon ill. Rex and I bringing him down to you this afternoon. Marie Lou must stop eating too. Kiss, Fleur, love, all. Derichlo.
He handed the wire to his wife with a puzzled smile.
Surely we're not going to take serious notice of this absurd telegram.
Richard, said Marie Lou, I do think we ought to do as he says.
Their butler, Malin, came out and announced the arrival of their guests. Hurried greetings were soon exchanged, and the whole party went into the drawing room.
Grey eyes, darling,
Marie Lou exclaimed as she stood on tiptoe to kiss Derichlo's lean cheek.
We had you telegram, and we are dying to know what it's all about. Have our servants conspired to poison us, or what?
What? Smiled Derichlo. Definitely what, princess? We have a very strange story to tell you, and I was most anxious you should avoid eating any meat for today, at all events.
Richard moved towards the bell.
Well, we're not debarred from a glass of your favourite sherry, I trust.
The Duke held up a restraining hand. I'm afraid we are. None of us must touch alcohol under any circumstances at present.
Good God, Richard exclaimed. You don't mean that. You can't. You've gone crazy.
I can quite understand your amazement, the Duke replied. But the truth is that Simon has been very seriously bewitched. He was sufficiently ill-advised to start dabbling in black magic a few months ago. Richard's brown eyes held the Duke's grey ones steadily.
Look here, he said. I'm far too fond of you ever to be rude intentionally, but hasn't this joke gone far enough? To talk about magic in the 20th century is absurd.
All right, call it natural science, then. Derichlo leaned a little wearily against the mantelpiece. Magic is only a name for the sciences of causing change to occur in conformity with will.
Or by setting natural laws in action quite inadvertently,
added Mary Lou to everyone's surprise.
Certainly, the Duke agreed after a moment. And Richard has practiced that type of magic himself.
What on earth are you talking about?
Richard exclaimed. Derichlo shrugged. Didn't you tell me that you got a diviner down from London when you were so terribly short of water here last summer? And that when you took his hazel twig from him, you found out quite by accident that you could locate an underground spring in the garden without his help?
Yes, Richard hesitated. That's true. Realizing at last that the Duke was perfectly serious. This seems a most extraordinary affair. I think you'd better start from the beginning and give us the whole story.
All right. Let's sit down. If you doubt any of the statements that I'm about to make, Rex will guarantee the facts and vouch for my sanity. Derichlo then told the Eatons all that had taken place in the last 48 hours and asked quite solemnly if they were prepared to receive Simon, Rex, and himself under their roof, in spite of the fact that it might involve some risk to themselves.
Of course, Marie Lou said at once. We would not dream of your going away. You must stay just as long as you like, and until you are quite certain that Simon is absolutely out of danger.
Richard, sceptical still, but devoted to his friends, whatever their apparent folly, nodded his agreement as he slipped an arm through his wife's.
Certainly you must stay. And, he added generously, tell us exactly how we can help you best.
The Duke nodded. Your help will be invaluable. You see, Simon's resistance is practically nil, owing to his having been under Mokata's influence for so long, and Rex and I are at a pretty low ebb after last night. We need every atom of vitality which we can get to protect him.
What do you wish us to do, Grey Eyes, dear?
Marie Lou asked the Duke. He hoisted himself out of the chair. I must drive to Oxford. An old Catholic priest whom I know lives there, and I'm going to try and persuade him to entrust me with a portion of the Blessed Host. If he will, that is the most perfect of all protections which we could have to keep with us through the night. In the meantime, I want the rest of you to look after Simon. The whole party filed into the hall and watched de Richelieu drive off. Then Richard, taking Simon by the arm, led him up the broad Jacobean stairway, while Marie-Lou turned to Rex.
"What do you really think of all this?"
she asked gravely. He answered,
"We've struck a gateway of hell, all right, and I'm just worried out of my wits. De Richelieu didn't give you the whole story. There's a girl in this that I'm crazy about."
"Rex, how awful for you. Come into my room and tell me everything."
He followed her, and for half an hour poured into her sympathetic ears the strange tale of his three glimpses of Tanith at different times abroad, and then his unexpected meeting with her at Simon's party, and was just beginning his anxious speculation as to what could have happened to Tanith when Melin, the butler, softly opened the door. "Someone is asking for you on the telephone, Mr. Van Rensselaer." "For me?" Rex stood up and, excusing himself to Marie-Lou, hurried out. A lilting voice came over the wire.
"Is that you, Rex? Oh, I'm glad I found you. I must see you at once, without a moment's delay."
"Tanith!" he exclaimed. "How did you tumble to it that I was here?"
"Oh, never mind that. I will tell you when I see you, but hurry, please."
"Where are you, then?"
"At the village inn, no more than a mile from you. Do come at once. It is very urgent."
For a second, Rex hesitated. Tanith's voice had all the urgency and agitation of extreme fear. He knew that he loved her now, loved her desperately. "All right," he answered. "I'll be right over." Running back across the hall, he explained breathlessly to Marie-Lou what had happened.
"You must go, of course," she said evenly. "But you will be back before nightfall, won't you, Rex?"
"Sure."
He hurried out and, leaving the house, set off at a trot by the shortcut across the meadows to the village. Unnoticed by him, a short figure entered the drive just as he disappeared beyond the boundary of the garden. A few moments later, the newcomer was in conversation with Melin. The butler knew that his master was upstairs, sitting with his friend Mr. Aaron while the latter rested, and had given orders that he was not to be disturbed. So, leaving the visitor in the hall, he crossed to Marie-Lou's sitting room.
"There is a gentleman to see you, madam," he announced. "Mr. Mokata."
In the last hour she had heard so much about this strange and terrifying visitor. Her first impulse was to send upstairs for Richard, but her brain was exceptionally quick. Rex and the Duke were both absent, and if she sent for Richard, Simon would be left alone.
"Show him in," she told the butler. "But if I ring, you are to come at once, immediately, you understand?"
"Certainly, madam."
Melin withdrew. Mokata was shown in.
"I do hope you'll forgive me, Mrs. Eaton, for calling on you without any invitation. But you may, perhaps, have heard my name."
She nodded, carefully ignoring the hand which he half extended. Marie-Lou knew nothing of esoteric doctrines, but quite enough from the peasant's superstitions, which had been rife in the little village where she had lived, an outcast of the Russian Revolution, to be aware that she must not touch this man, nor offer him any form of refreshment while he was in her house. He went on.
"Simon Aaron is a very dear friend of mine, and during his recent illness, I've been taking care of him."
"I see," she answered. "Well, it was hardly put to me in that way."
Marie-Lou caught herself thinking that he was really quite an attractive person. His voice was strangely pleasant and restful to listen to as he spoke.
"I'm certain that nothing could be more charming for him than your hospitality. Unfortunately, there are certain matters of which you naturally know nothing, but which make it quite imperative that I should take him back to London tonight."
"I'm afraid that is quite impossible."
"I see. I feared that you might take this attitude to begin with, because I imagine our friend de Richelieu has been filling the heads of your husband and yourself with the most preposterous nonsense.
I do ask you to believe me, Mrs. Eaton, when I say that Simon will be in very considerable danger if you do not allow me to take him back into my house.
No danger will come to him as long as he is in my house, said Marilou firmly.
Ah, my dear young lady, I can hardly expect anyone like yourself to understand precisely what will happen to our poor Simon if he remains here. But his mental state has been unsatisfactory for some little time, and I alone can cure him of his lamentable condition. Chocolates, he added suddenly. You'll think me terribly rude, but may I? I simply adore chocolates.
I'm so sorry, Marilou replied, but that box is empty. Do go on what you were saying about Simon.
Really? What a pity. May I put it in the waste paper basket for you, then?
He picked up the box, realizing by its weight that she had lied to him.
No, please.
She almost snatched the box from his pudgy fingers.
I gave it to my little girl to put her marbles in. We mustn't throw it away.
The box gave a faint rustle as she laid it down beside her.